The Choir by Joanna Trollope. The book's dedication reads, "For Ian." The book is preceded by a quotation from George Meredith. "Full lasting is the song, though he the singer passes. Lasting too, for souls not lent in usury, the rapture of the forward view." Acknowledgements. Needless to say, all the characters in this novel are entirely fictitious, but there are several real people to whom I owe a great debt of gratitude for their time and experience, and for the chances they gave me to learn at first hand about life in a cathedral choir. I should like to thank most warmly the Reverend Alan Charters, headmaster of the King's School, Gloucester, Mr. John Saunders, organist and director of music at Gloucester Cathedral, Mr. Harry Mudd, managing director of the Abbey Recording Company, Mr. Andrew Shenton, organist and director of music at St. Matthew's Church, Northampton, who allowed me to sit in on the recording session of Daniel Ludford Thomas, BET Choir Boy of the Year. Joanna Trollope, Gloucestershire. Chapter 1. Nicholas Elliot, who had had many reverses in his young life, pushed open the inner door of the cathedral porch and heard the singing. It was early, not much after 8 in the morning, and outside the cathedral there had been no sound but the wind and a few gulls looping, crying round the tower. Now, with the felt-padded door softly shut behind him, he could hear nothing at all but the singing, far off but very clear. They were singing Palestrina's Tu es Petrus. He began to walk rapidly on tiptoe across the back of the nave towards the north transept. In the corner of the transept was a door he had opened every morning for 4 years, which gave on to a flight of stone steps that led up to the practice room. That room was where they were singing now, 24 choristers among the music stands and the dust, with the miniature cricket stumps on the disordered mantelpiece, the stacks of psalters on the scuffed benches and chairs, the engravings of past organists askew on the walls. When Nicholas had been head chorister, he had stood and sung beneath William Good, vastly fat and hugely benign, who had played the Altminster organ from 1782 until 1801. The door at the foot of the staircase was open. The singing had stopped. "And what," said the voice of the organist, clearly from 20 feet above Nicholas, "is that sharp doing there, may I ask?" Memory filled Nicholas's mouth with the taste of stale Weetabix, imperfectly brushed from his teeth in the early morning panic. He could hear his mother, as they dashed erratically along the city's ring road, shrieking that she would never have countenanced his being a chorister if only she had known. "If it's 3-2, Wooldridge," said the organist, "what is it? Come on, come on." "3 minim, sir." "Now, find that anthem, the baton one. It's the one you will sing in procession. Listen to this note. Now, a nice round O." Probably. In fact, certainly, he was playing the same old Steinway up there, with its keyboard facing the huge diamond-paned window blurry with dust and its top heaped with sheet music in sliding piles. "Look," the organist said, "the altos have got the tune, haven't they?" Nicholas could smell the smell up there, dust and paper and boy. He was sick with envy. Under his hands he could feel his old copy of Bird's Magnificat in its thin, stiff red covers, with a cathedral crest stamped on the title page and "Not to be taken away" underneath in purple ink. "Now," said the organist, "we haven't much time left. Talis, if ye love me, right up to commandments in one breath, and you've got to do a bit of counting, all right?" "All right, Hooper. First time round, that's only 2 beats. 5 minutes later, when the organist came down the steps to the transept in a skirmishing crowd of boys, amiably bashing at each other with carrier bags and fiddle cases, he found a perfectly strange young man on a bench by the wall, gripped by a paroxysm of weeping. "I gave him to Sandra," Leo Beckford said to the headmaster of the King's School at break. "Who did you give to Sandra?" "The chap I found in the cathedral this morning. He said he was a chorister here once, head chorister in 1976. I've looked him up and he was. I was awfully moved by him." It seems to me that he was seeking sanctuary somehow. Are you listening? Sorry, Alexander Troy said. Not really. I know he isn't your responsibility, really, but as an old boy... The headmaster twitched his gown more securely onto his impressive shoulders. Tell Sandra, she's so competent, I expect she'll feed him. I have, she did. She sent him into breakfast, and he was overjoyed that it was still bacon and tinned tomatoes on Wednesdays. Are you all right? No, Alexander said, I am not, but I can't talk about it just now, not even to you. Sorry. When he had plunged out of the common room, Leo knew that his own protective colouring had, as usual, gone with him. Leo disliked the common room. He had no place there, not being on the staff, and he only came in to find the headmaster or to do battle, to explain, as temperately as he could, to one master after another, why choir practice must take precedence over football practice and cricket practice and rowing practice and athletic practice. He began to move towards the door, and somebody said, "Beckford!" And he unwisely said, "Yes?" And the athletics coach, who taught woodwork in winter, said, "About Wooldridge, Beckford, not today, but we sing..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.